Yeah, yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so we'll start with the introduction, sir.
Okay.
Good afternoon, doctors. I am Anil Yadav. I am RSM for Dr. Reddy's Laboratories, Mumbai. I welcome you all to this CME on glycolazide today. And as you are aware, today there will be two topics which will be covered. One is glycolazide, an ideal SU to navigate your type 2 diabetes patient safely towards euglycemia. And the second one is an Indian study on glycolazide, which is recently published. And I have a great pleasure in welcoming Dr. Nikhil Prabhu, diabetologist practicing in Mumbai, today for the session. And just to give you a brief introduction about Dr. Nikhil Prabhu, Dr. Nikhil Prabhu is a consultant diabetologist practicing at Haut Diabetes Care, Ghatkopar, over the last 5 years. He is also practicing at Govandi and Mankhurd area. And he has over 7,000 patients who are currently taking diabetes and thyroid treatment under him. Dr. Nikhil Prabhu has completed his MBBS from RCSM, Government Medical College, Kolhapur. He has completed his CPS in diabetology from Kokilaben Ambani Hospital, Andheri. And he has also completed his fellowship in diabetes from Liverpool Academy, UK. He is member of United Diabetes Forum and also a member of Endocrine Society. With that brief introduction, I welcome Dr. Nikhil Prabhu to take over the session. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, first of all, for Dr. Reddy's team to give me an opportunity to present today. Without wasting much of time, we'll start with the first topic. That is the effect of glycolazide or glycolazide plus metformin combination on glycemic control in type 2 diabetes patient in India, a real-world retrospective longitudinal observational study from electronic medical records. So, Indian real-world effectiveness of glycolazide or glycolazide metformin combination. The study sample was around 500 patients, and they are measured glucose readings apart 90 days, so almost 3 months apart. The readings were taken. The sample size was around 500 patients. This is a retrospective longitudinal observational real-world study. The electronic medical record source was HealthPlix Technologies. Study population EMR data of the Indian type 2 diabetes patients on oral antidiabetic drugs. The two HbA1c readings after at least 90 days of treatment. The duration of the study from January 2016 to October 2019. Here the patients were put on the glycolazide only as the first line, or they have added as an add-on therapy to the other OADs. Similarly, the patient were started newly on the glycolazide metformin combination, and in the other arm, they were started glycolazide and metformin was added as an add-on to other OADs. So out of 500 roughly patients, the glycolazide only patients were 66, whom their HbA1c was greater than 6.5. And on the second arm, HbA1c was greater than 7. So here you can say there are four different categories basically. Plain glycolazide, newly added, glycolazide and metformin only newly added, then plain glycolazide added on the other OADs, and glycolazide metformin combination added on the other OADs. So these are four different categories here. The study was in the four different arms. And HbA1c greater than 6.5 and HbA1c greater than 7. The number of patients were around 66, 179, 169, and 84. How they are gathered, we'll see in the next slide. So here in this slide, total around 10 lakhs patients who were diagnosed on type 2 diabetes between January 2016 to 10 October 2019. So there was a total 10 lakh sample, out of which those who have prescribed on sulfonylureas, these are basically according to the EMR, electronic medical record of the HealthPlix. So total prescribed sulfonylureas patients were around 1,47,000, and those patients who were prescribed sulfonylureas and bigonides, that those were around 4,70,000. Out of that, they are further categorized. And in the first arm, those who were prescribed sulfonylureas, out of them, around 51,000 patients were put on the glycalazide. And out of that 51,000 patients, the patients newly initiated on the glycalazide only, or they were prescribed glycalazide for less than 30 days. Those were around 4,000 patients. You can say, see that in the left side of the chart. Out of that 4,000, those who have a greater HbA1c than 6.5 at the baseline, they were around 722. And after that, those patients who have rechecked their HbA1c after 19 days, though the sample size came to 66. Similarly, those where glycalazide was added on to other OADs, that was around 6,300 patients. Then those who have greater than 6.5 HbA1c was around 1,447 patients. And those patients, out of those patients, checked after 90 days again. So the sample size came around 169. Similarly, when we started those patients on glycalazide and metformin combination initially, the sample size was 8,200. After that, those patients who have HbA1c greater than 6.5 at the baseline was around 1,295. And those patients who have followed up after 90 days of the treatment, the sample size came to 179. And similarly, glycalazide and metformin combination with as an add-on to other OADs, the sample size came to 84. So these are basically four here. You can say see in the previous slide how these numbers came. 66, 179, 169 and 84. How this number came. In this slide, here is the distribution of them, how the study was conducted. So study endpoints, basically the primary endpoint, the mean change in the HbA1c from the baseline of 90 days of the treatment. The secondary endpoints were assessment of dosage and formulation of glycalazide or glycalazide metformin, assessment of anti-hyperglycemic agents to which glycalazide or glycalazide metformin were added as an adjunct. HbA1c levels in the Indian population, HbA1c was greater than 7. Here you can say in the first visit, when those patients who have a glycalazide only, the baseline HbA1c was 8.4, and after second visit, means after 90 days, it came to 7.6. When we added glycalazide, used glycalazide metformin combination, HbA1c came down from 9 to 7.4. As a glycalazide plane add-on to other OADs, HbA1c came down from 8.6 to 7.4, and as an add-on of glycalazide and metformin combination to other OADs, the HbA1c reduction was from 9.1 to 7.6. Similarly, in the HbA1c level in Indian patient where A1c is greater than or equal to 6.5, similar reductions can be seen with the glycalazide and metformin combination. Glycalazide plain as an add-on and glycalazide metformin combination as an add-on. The HbA1c reduction you can see in this slide. So comparatively, you can see here when plain glycalazide was added, around 0.6 to 0.8% HbA1c reduction. Glycalazide added as a single add-on, 1.6 to 1.3. HbA1c reduction. When added newly started on the glycalazide metformin combination, HbA1c reduction was roughly around 1.2, and as an add-on to the other OADs glycalazide metformin combination, the HbA1c reduction was around 1.2 to 1.4%. But it was always a reduction across the HbA1c baseline in all the study arms. Now in this there was different combinations of glycalazide were used for the study. Intermediate release 40, 80 and 160, as well as the glycalazide extended release combinations 30 and 60. So here you can see the glycalazide only patients 37, 24 and 5. So here the total counting comes to 66. You can see that in the previous slides. I'm just taking it back. See, this is the plain glycalazide, where 66 patients of the HbA1c greater than 6.5 were added. So out of that, the distribution is like this. Around 9 were on 40 mg, 1 on 80, 1 on 160 immediate release, and 26 on the extended release. Similarly, their HbA1c baseline was 6.5 to 8%, 8.1 to 10%, and greater than 10%. Similarly, when the glycolazide and metformin combination was added, the strength use was 40 plus 500, 80 plus 500, and extended release was 30 plus 500 and 60 plus 500. The other OADs, the anti-hyperglycemic agents to which glycolazide or glycolazide metformin were added. So here you can see bigonides were 141 metformin, DPP-4 inhibitors 133. So you will see as the patients were on the number of OADs at the same time. So that this number is counted as differently, single they will increase in the number. Some patients were more than one drug class simultaneously. So these patients were using a combination where DPP-4. So there is a chances that the patient were on DPP-4 inhibitor, insulin, as well as glycolazide. Or there were a combinations where bigonoids there, glycolazides there, and other SGLT2 inhibitors, or maybe alpha glucosidase inhibitor simultaneously. That's why the number is more. But here you can see the add-ons were with other OADs is bigonides 141, DPP-4 133, and insulin 71. These are the majority of the other combinations used. So on conclusion, the effectiveness of glycolazide and glycolazide metformin prescribed to an Indian patient with the type 2 diabetes mellitus during the routine clinical practice in the India was assessed using the electronic medical record data. The glycolazide or glycolazide metformin prescribed as a monotherapy or as an add-on therapy during the routine clinical practice effectively reduced the HbA1c in Indian type 2 diabetes patients. And glycolazide can be an ideal choice for if sulfonylurea is being considered. So now navigating safety towards the euglycemia. In this slide, you can see this is a normal physiological balance of sugar maintenance. Basically, whenever there is a hypoglycemia, the pancreas secretes alpha glucagon to increase the blood sugar levels. And when there is a hyperglycemia, pancreas secretes beta cells. So it increases the uptake of glucose in fat and muscles, and as well as stores in the liver as a glycogen. Glucose is converted into glycogen and stored in the liver, so the plasma levels come down. So this is a physiological slide basically showing how the glycemic state is maintained in the body in non-diabetic patient, normal human being. Now type 2 diabetes management and euglycemia. Euglycemia refers to having a normal range of blood sugar levels. The goal of type 2 diabetes management is to attain close to the state of euglycemia as safely as possible, avoiding both hyperglycemia as well as hypoglycemia. Navigating towards the euglycemia is a journey towards the glycemic control. Non-euglycemic states, hyperglycemia, there is a diabetic ketoacidosis or HHS. In hypoglycemia, loss of consciousness, seizure, death can harm. Long-term complications of diabetes, cardiovascular disease, peripheral vascular disease, nephropathy, neuropathy, and retinopathy, both micro and macrovascular. Sulfonylureas in oral combination therapy. One of the first add-on option in the latest ADA and ESD guidelines, sulfonylurea is there after the metformin. We can use either DPP-4, SGLT2 or sulfonylurea after the metformin. Effective and safe as initial therapy is used in combination with lifestyle modification and metformin in patients with HbA1c greater than or equal to 7.5%. The fixed dose combinations containing modern sulfonylureas like glycolazide modified release are effective, safe and convenient during the OD dosing. Glycolazide modified release or modern sulfonylurea. In this slide here, you can see the conventional sulfonylureas are tolbutamide and glibenclamide. The modern sulfonylureas includes glimepiride, glycolazide modified release, and glipizide modified release. The classification based on the action, short acting is tolbutamide, intermediate acting is glipizide and glycolazide, and long acting glibenclamide, glimepiride, glipizide MR, and glycolazide MR. Here, intermediate acting, when we consider glipizide, it has around 6 hours action time. The glycolazide plane is around 18 hours, and modified releases of glycolazide and glimepiride is around 24 hours action, so long acting. Navigating safety towards the euglycemia, glycolazide effectiveness. Here in this slide, it is a meta-analysis of 229 study. Here you can see the glycemic control with glycolazide extended release formulation is comparable with metformin and glimepiride. So almost 1% HbA1c reduction. Improved glucose control with the progressive up titration. As we increase the doses, 30 mg extended release glycolazide, then 60 mg, 90 mg, and 120 mg, there is a decrease in the HbA1c across the HbA1c spectrum. EZDR study, this is. So as we increase the dose, up titration, the HbA1c reduction is more. Now, effect of glycolazide and glycolazide plus metformin combination. This is the same study just we have discussed. Again, the same slide. Here you can see the HbA1c reduction in the four different categories. HbA1c reduction in Indian patient, X-RISE study. About 8 out of 10 patients were able to achieve glycemic control, HbA1c less than 7% with glycolazide XR 60 mg. And almost 1.5% reduction in HbA1c with the extended release glycolazide formulations. Then there is a GLIDE study, glycolazide MR versus the glimepiride. Here you can see glycolazide MR is at least as effective as glimepiride. As we see, the modified release glycolazide has a comparable action with glimepiride. Even in 5 intensive arm, here you can see HbA1c reduction of 1% is maintained even after the 5 years, according to the advanced study. Now the maintaining euglycemia, glycolazide treatment and durability. Glycolazide versus other sulfonylureas. When we see the secondary treatment failure after 5 years, it is least of for glycolazide among the other sulfonylureas drugs. So here you can see only 7% has secondary treatment failure after 5 years with glycolazide. So effect is quite persistent. The HbA1c reduction is quite persistent throughout the 5 years, and even after the 5 years. So now, according to the advanced trial, maintain control over 5 years. Here you can see that in the intensive arm, HbA1c less than 6% was achieved in 21%. HbA1c less than or equal to 6.5 were achieved in 64.9%. And HbA1c less than 7% were achieved in 81.1%. Safety towards low risk of glycolazide has a low risk of hypoglycemia. In this slide here, you can see there is a low risk of hypoglycemia with glycolazide. This is especially due to a biphasic pulsatile glucose dependent insulin secretion. There is a restoration of the early insulin peak. Along with that, it also has a low benzamide moiety, freely dissociates from the receptor. And it does not bind with EPAC. EPAC is basically a receptor stimulator which stimulates basically the exocytosis of the insulin, EPAC2. So it does not bind, so it is loosely bind. Glycolazide can be used as a safely during the Ramadan. Here you can see the hypoglycemia, symptomatic hypoglycemia during the Ramadan. In the randomized control trial, the glycolazide has almost very low incidences comparable with sitagliptin. Compared to the other sulfonylureas, it is almost 50% less hypoglycemia events when we compare it with glimepiride, glibenclamide, or overall other sulfonylureas. In this slide, you can see glycolazide has 6.6 and other sulfonylureas is around 13, 12, and glibenclamide has the most, 19.7. Now, glycolazide during the Ramadan. Even fasting patients can safely maintain the glycemic control with evening administration of glycolazide modified daily 60 mg. The modified glycolazide dose can be given at the iftar, basically the larger meal, when during the Ramadan, when the patient breaks the Ramadan fast and they take the iftar meal. At that time, if you use a modified release glycolazide, it gives a overall 24-hour effect, so with least chances of hypoglycemia. Proportion of patients reporting greater than one symptomatic hypoglycemia events during the Ramadan was low, 2.2, with glycolazide modified release. So here you can say it is safe to use during the Ramadan as well. Guide study, glycolazide MR versus glimepiride. Here you can see that there is a almost 50% fewer confirmed hypoglycemic episode with glycolazide MR compared to the glimepiride. Now, glycolazide CV outcomes. The CV outcome, here you can see clearly the glycolazide has a strong affinity for SUR1 receptor, but glycolazide lacks the affinity towards cardiac SUR2A receptors. So there is no cardiac affinity, so it is much safe to use, and it preserves the ischemic preconditioning. Basically other sulfonylureas, even glimepiride, glibenclamide, acts on the SUR2A and SUR2B receptors. But you can see here that glycolazide has a selective SUR1, that is a pancreatic specific action. So it is much safe. Glycolazide has a lower CV risk than the other insulin secretagogues. Danish registry. Again, here you can see the glycolazide has a favorable results when we compared with the other sulfonylureas. So glycolazide has a lower all-cause mortality as well as and CV related mortality risk. The comparison is favorable towards glycolazide here when compared with the other sulfonylureas. Glycolazide did not increase the risk of stroke. Here you can see there is a very low risk with MACE, cardiovascular myocardial infarction and stroke when compared with the glimepiride. The association of glucose lowering medications with cardiovascular outcomes, an umbrella review and evidence map. This is the recent study, actually in 2020 this has been carried out, and it suggests glycolazide did not increase the risk of stroke. Advanced study, major macro and microvascular events. So there is around 10% relative risk reduction of combined major micro and macro, both events, with glycolazide modified release. Now the glycolazide renal outcomes. There is a lower risk of doubling of creatinine versus glimepiride. Here in study, this you can see that the creatinine levels are compared to glimepiride, these are less. So creatinine doubling is lesser with glycolazide compared to glimepiride. in CKD patients. 21% reduction in the nephropathy. These are also a favorable outcomes. The intensive arm of the advance suggests this. There is also a 65% reduction in the risk of end-stage renal disease and 20% reversal to normal albuminuria. These are according to the advance 5 years data. Then there is a 46% reduction in the end-stage renal disease intensive arm. Overall 46% reduction in end-stage renal disease. Better outcomes with the preserved kidney function. So here you can see the glycolazide can be used without dose adjustment in CKD stage 3, 4 and 5. Even when there is a EGFR less than 30, you can safely use glycolazide. With glimepiride and other sulfonylureas, there are the higher chances. Of glimepiride, at least as effective as glimepiride, either as a monotherapy or in combination. Glycolazide helps in navigating patients safely towards the glycemic goal with the low risk of hypoglycemia as compared to the other sulfonylureas. Glycolazide have favorable CV and renal outcomes and it is weight neutral. Glycolazide helps in the glycemic control while fasting and does not need dose adjustment in the CKD. So glycolazide is a sulfonylurea with a difference. It has a low risk of hypoglycemia, renal safety, CV safety and weight neutrality. So it is an ideal choice in type 2 diabetes management in case of sulfonylureas were considered. Thank you.
Hello, sir. There are some questions in the chat box. Sir.
Yes. Yeah. I am reading this.
Yeah.
So it's Dr. Sandesh Kaye is asking, what is the preference sulfonylurea combination used in CKD patient? Dr. Sandesh, in my opinion, the shorter acting is much better combination used with the in CKD patient. So if you consider, ideally you can use repaglinide or urepa basically. It is a very shorter acting this. And in sulfonylureas, you can use either glipizide or glycolazide. But you need to be careful as the renal function is deteriorated. There are higher chances that the drug won't get excreted out of the body. And there are higher chances of hypoglycemia. So the preferred one is shorter acting, either glipizide or glycolazide.
So, are we done with all the questions?
Yes, I think.
Okay.
Yes,
there are no more questions. So, with your permission, I would like to conclude the session, sir.
Okay, sure.
Thank you so much, sir.
Okay.
Okay. Bye-bye, sir.
Bye.